For I should say generations, industrial manufacturing has been the heart of Michigan's economy, spawning the need for thousands of engineers to help keep our factories running. Michigan engineers have helped the American manufacturing sector and the automotive industry in particular achieve the highest rates of productivity in the world. That legacy has left Michigan with more engineers per capita, as was commented on earlier. But as we move forward, the need for engineers is predicted to grow around the globe as companies seek to improve productivity and efficiency. In the years to come, engineering services are predicted to grow at a rate that far outpaces the economy as a whole. It's especially promising for advanced technologies like automotive, aerospace, medical devices, and precision instruments. In these high-tech fields, improving productivity through engineering solutions is especially valuable. Engineers will be needed not only to improve Michigan's productivity, but also the state can realize new growth opportunities by broadening its engineering base into other industries. And with me today, Chris and Rich, thanks so much for joining
us.
We're going to talk a little bit more about this. And you'll have an opportunity at the end to ask them some questions. So those action plans, mark them down, and we'll talk about it over lunch. So we'll kick it off with a question to Rich. We hear that employers prefer to hire engineers who have experience. Rich, is that true? And if so, how do we make sure that our engineers have the skills that are needed by businesses?
It's true, but it's not exclusive. We at Dow, we like to hire both people off campus and people who are experienced. If we have a specific need for a specific talent, then we tend to go to the experienced hires. But we still maintain a large on-campus presence because we want to get in the fresh crop, the new thinking, and believe me, this new generation, you heard it in the last panel, this new generation of engineers that are coming out challenge all of us. So we enjoy bringing those in. So it's a balance of both. It's still heavily weighted towards the new hires, but experience are out there if we need them for specific needs.
Now, Chris, can you tell us a little bit about what the Engineering Society of Detroit is doing to increase Michigan's talent supply?
ESD is multidisciplined, so we reach about 65,000 professionals and 3,000 companies and over 50 unions. So we have a broad mix at the Engineering Society of Detroit. We have programs that are dedicated to different aspects, and we look at the engineering village of business leaders in Michigan as a sort of a pipeline. We see it as a made in Michigan pipeline that starts when children are young, to nurture them through the process, through early years, through middle school, high school, ultimately college or community college, to be able to go into an engineering profession. It's very important, and it needs the nudge from the business community. That's why we're glad to be here today.
Excellent. Well, one way that companies can obtain talent is to use those internship programs and co-op programs. And Rich, I understand that you actually are a product of one of those. Can you tell us a little bit about your experience and how it helped you get through the doors at Dow?
Yeah, certainly. Many years ago, I was an intern for the Dow Chemical Company. And it was a great experience for me, and I would say it led to the success I have today. Because what it allowed me to do was to see not only Dow, but I got to see the industry, and I got to see a part of the world that I would not have ever gone to work in. I'm a Midwesterner from Minnesota, went to college in South Dakota, and I ended up getting an internship in Texas, South Texas, where they don't have winter at all, and they have one heck of a summer. I went down there, and I kind of said, well, I'll go down there and do the 3 months, but I'm going to really look for a job in the Midwest. And went down there and had a great experience. I came in, I saw what, I got to make that transition from the books to real life, and I got to do it over a four-month period. And I saw how an engineer applies his trade. And it was a great experience. The company took very good care of me, and when I left there to go back to my senior year of college, I had no doubt that I was going to be back in Texas and be a Texas person. Again, because internships allow the individual, the student, to see what the real life is all about and to make that very important transition early. From a company perspective, it allows us to get a good look at these individuals. You do the normal campus recruiting, our interview, you bring them back to a company. If there's interest, you spend a day with them. You get some sense what they're like. But when you get to spend 3 months, and in a co-op, when a Dow co-op, you get to have them for four three-month periods. So you get to see them for over a year. You know you're going to get somebody good. And so that's why on our co-op and internship program, nearly 80% of those that we offer a job come back to work for now. So there's actually an economic reason for doing it. You don't have to spend as much money on recruiting. And again, we get to see the quality of the individual we see coming in.
So how many internships do you go through a year, and how many kids are coming
out
of the co-ops?
At just our site up in Midland, we have at any one time, we have between 60 and 70 students working in our facility. So that's year-round because we have a summer internship, we have a fall, and then we have a spring, depending on where the students are.
See, now parents out there, this is where you want to send your kids.
Yeah.
So, Chris, how can we increase global recognition of Michigan's engineering capabilities? We talked about that in the last panel. How do we grow those beyond just the auto industry?
You know, the how question is the tough one. I think most everybody in this room has an answer that we could probably agree on, or answers we could agree on for the what. On the how, that's really what the Institute tries to do. We recently did the STEM symposium, where basically just some facts, and you may know them, that over the next decade, 80% of our job growth in the U.S. is going to be STEM related. So, and we also face, we think, in 2020, that roughly National Science Foundation says this, that we'll have over 500,000 engineers that don't have a job. We'll have a shortage of that, I mean. So, and in Southeast Michigan, we have 5 openings and only 1 engineer to fill it. So we have today, I think, a shortage, and we've got to address it. I think what Rich is talking about is a great, I'll call it a huge, wonderful silo. And what we now need to do, I think, is to come together, especially in the private sector, and collaborate with the public sector to try to give it sustainability. And that means a training program that really goes into the inner cities, into our communities, and becomes a part of that education process. If we do that, and that's what some of our findings, I think, are going to be out of the STEM symposium, I think we will have the workforce, and they'll want to be here because we will have engaged them from the very beginning.
So this is a question for the both of you. How can we help our existing engineering companies export services and serve broader markets? What kind of support mechanisms do we need to put in place? I guess I'll start with you.
I think, that's a good question. First, we have to get people to want to be engineers. That's the biggest challenge we have. Chris was just talking about it. And so how do we, when you look at our world is full, turn on the news tonight, it's full of problems. People are always trying to solve a problem, or they're always talking about a problem, not working towards solution. Hmm. Engineers, there's no such thing as a problem. That's an opportunity, okay? And that's what engineers do. So we've got to get more and more people so we don't have the shortage and we can start solving those problems. And so right now what we have to do is get people understanding what engineering is all about and getting those middle school and high school students interested in the STEM careers, science, technology, engineering, and math, and then getting them into our great university so they can become the engineers of the future. Otherwise, we're going to have a gap in problem solvers, and if we don't solve our problems, they're only going to get worse. And then once we do that, we've got to be able to give them the careers, the jobs that they want to have and they can be successful in. But that's happening. I'm not all worried about that. You know, you heard him talk about the systems engineering approach in our last panel. When I think about the engineers that come and work at Dow, we have a large automotive presence up in Midland. We have three plants that serve just the automotive industry. And so those engineers aren't just sitting in the plant in Midland and keeping that plant running. They're out working with the automotive group. I was with a couple of them yesterday at the Michigan, and I forget who they played, basketball game. And before the game, we were talking about that, how our engineers go down with the OEMs and find out what they need in the next generation of our automobiles, and then we come back and through our R&D facilities and into our plants. And, you know, if we can get that word out there, look what you get to do when you come be an engineer. You get to go work in that next generation of automobile. Mm. So it's putting that whole package together, and then it's a bit of marketing and selling it to our next generation.
You know, Michigan has, of course, all these rich assets, and its people are really it. I think investment will go where the people are and where the talent is. We know that. Sustainability for Michigan and how do we make it happen, we need to think out of the box. For instance, Michigan right now, we should distinguish between, I think, pure engineering and applied engineering. Generally speaking, your university centers, those corridors and so forth, will always be working what I call the pure engineering side. The applied side goes with manufacturing. And our worry at the Engineering Society of Detroit is that as manufacturing continues to go offshore, then the engineers go offshore. So I think Rich would be the first to say that if he needs to find engineers, he can find them offshore more readily sometimes than we can here.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So I think we have to address, and we plan to do this next manufacturing symposium of looking at that. But we need to lower our costs on a sustainable basis, and that goes beyond incentivization. And I think we can, for instance, ideas that are being tossed are a unified law system where Michigan would be the first state without workers' compensation. We would take advantage of, I think, the healthcare opportunity we have and turn it into a positive so that business can lower their costs sustainably and they'll line up to come here to use our infrastructure, to use what I think Michigan has, which is talent that's very rich, as well as an infrastructure and a location that's perfect.
Now, Chris, you are also operating a program in the schools where you're reaching out right into the classrooms and engaging many of our kids and showing them the exciting opportunities that exist.
You know, I'm glad I went that way and I should have gone that way. I think an answer to engaging the children, our students, is giving them, when they see a math formula, and there's no great inflation in that, you either get it or you don't, so it's tough. You know, it looks in the abstract like it's boring. But let's say we give them a problem to solve pollution in a particular lake right by the school. Now they're engaged in solving a real-world problem. So what the Germans have done for years, it's the BIBB organization, they have put industry, educators, and business together in the room to figure out what is the most effective curriculum to grow the best workers. And I think Michigan, we will be rolling that out, but I think Michigan should look at a cooperative or collaborative authority that could be doing that to help guide the educators. Because if we can continue, and as you know, our MEEP scores, everybody's aware that these have dropped, it's serious, it's a serious problem. But if we engage them in real-world problems, I think the kids are going to really have the nudge, wow, I can use this formula to solve that pollution problem, or whatever it might be, and I think we could really bring them to engineering.
Let me add to that. We're starting to see pockets of that happening in this state. You know, up in Midland, where we're located, we don't have the critical mass. We're kind of by ourselves up there. And so we were struggling to get the skilled trades and the people who are going to operate our plants long-term. Mm-hmm. The process operators, who used to just come straight out of high school, we'd hire them, we'd bring them in. If they were strong enough to open a valve and climb a ladder, then they were qualified. Those days are long gone. So we set in place our operators had to have a certain level of education. Well, we couldn't hire any of those because they just weren't there. They certainly weren't in mid-Michigan, and we were having a hard time finding them. So we had to get together and do it ourselves. And what we did is we formed a private-public partnership with a local community college and some representative, Dr. Gene Goodnow is here today, Dr. Goodnow. And working with Delta College, we have put together a training program that teaches our next generation of process operators, and we couldn't be happier. But we need to do that across this entire state so that we can get those people that need to man our plants, operate our plants long-term so that we can be successful.
Excellent. Well, in wrap-up, I think the key takeaway here is that we clearly are a powerhouse of engineering talent, and our ability to offer end-to-end solutions is what we need to capitalize on, and to be able to market Engineered in Michigan is a good way to build on our future. Now, you may have more questions for these two. They're going to be available around the lunch hour, so make sure you mark them down, and we'll talk to you a little later on today. Thank you, gentlemen,
Thank
for joining
you.
Us. Let's give them a round of applause.
Thank you.